topic is rise and fall of Indian civilization. So before we start, please turn off your phone or make the silence mode. And during the talk, if you have questions, please write down your questions on the paper that we gave you. As you can see, the topic is, the speaker is Jose Arbila Petroche. He studies in Joseon University. And the topic is Rise and Fall of Andean Civilization. Please give him a big applause.
Hello everybody, my name is Jose Avila Petroche. I am from the beautiful country of Peru, and in this opportunity I'm really glad to present this topic, Rise and Fall of Andean Civilizations. I hope you really enjoy this talk. So first I want to ask you, and please take a few seconds to think about what did you know about South American history before the Spanish conquest. Please take a few seconds, maybe you remember something from school, university. I want to show you some pictures. Can you recognize this place? Not the llama, the place behind it. Machu Picchu, one of the seven wonders from Peru. What about this one? This is a little bit tricky, maybe. That is Chan Chan. It's one of the biggest old cities in the pre-Hispanic America. I'm going to talk about Chan Chan later. What about this one? It's really important place in the Andean region. It's not in Peru, it's called Tiwana in Bolivia. And what about this one? I think this is kind of famous. You have seen this one.
Nazca
Valley. Yeah, and it's not made by aliens, it's made by one culture that is called Nazca. So we're going to explore who was the civilizations. What were the civilizations who built these big monuments for humanity? So I'm going to start this topic talking about the first arrival of people to South America more than 12,000 years ago, and I'm going to finish with maybe you know the Incas. Inca Empire. But you see, there is a big gap. What happened before the Incas? That is the topic today. So, we don't know. We are going to start to fill this gap. This is the outline. At first, I'm going to talk about general things about the geography of South America, about domestication, and then the Andean civilizations. In five periods, since the formative until the Inca Empire, that is called the Late Horizon. This is the geographical background of South America. This is South America, many places here, and I want to focus in the Andean change. Then the change goes from Colombia up to the southern part of Chile. Most of the civilizations that I'm going to talk in this presentation developed in the central area of the Andean chain, in the continent that is now Ecuador, Peru, Bolivia, and Chile, northern Chile. So keep in mind, we're going to talk about these parts. But in the Andean chain, you can find many ecosystems. You can find things, for example, a big desert, no? That is a really dry desert, but it's not hot. But in this desert, you can also find several rivers. And near to the rivers is really good for agriculture. So we start to the desert, we are going to the mountains, we start to find these valleys between the mountains, a really important place for agriculture production too. And then we reach the top. This region is called Janka, is almost covered, always covered by snow. Okay, coldest places in the world. And then if we go to the eastern slopes of the mountains, we start to find a lot of vegetation. And finally, we arrive to the Amazon class, of the Amazon region. But you see, it's a really a lot of variety in the ecosystem, in the desert, and in the jungle, and in very cold, cold areas. So first, I'm going to start here. The first arrival of people to South America. This is the route that the first people followed through the Bering Strait. Actually, the origin of the Native Americans are Mongoloid from the North Asia. North Asia. This is the main origin of the Native American people. Although some of them have a non-Mongoloid origin, but it's a less percentage. So actually they crossed the Bering Strait, arrived in South America. Some people decided to go to what is now Colombia and Venezuela, and other people stay near to the coast, and then off to the mountains. So, I have to say that this was in the late Pleistocene period. All of them were hunters that were looking for animals. They strongly depend on year-round plants. And if they decide to stay in the marine area, in the coast area, they strongly depend on marine resources. Why? Because the sea here between Peru and Chile is one of the most productive places in the world, talking about marine resources. So, sorry to move. When did the sedentary life begin? Around 10,000 years ago. Why? Because the productivity started in this. They start to find more plants, more animals. Why? Because this period, the Holocene, we could find warmer temperatures than the previous period. So the temperatures start to rise, more productivity, more plants, more animals, and that is the reason that the people start to settle down in different places. What places? Pacific coast, central coast mainly, the central Andes and the Altiplano. This is an area called Altiplano. Gulf of Guayaquil, really important. In Colombia, near to the Magdalena River, and near to the Orinoco River in Venezuela. This is the first areas of settlements. So we have other key point here. Sedentaries, 10,000 years ago, in the early Holocene. What happened next? If I stay in a place, then I decide to domesticate plants and animals because we have a really good environment. In South America, many species of plants has been domesticated. The most important, potato, and this is also really important, especially for American people, quinoa. Really, it have a lot of vitamins, many minerals. Most of them were domesticated in the southern part of Peru. Here and northern part of Bolivia. Cotton and beans, southern part of Ecuador, northern part of Peru. And coca. The coca leaves, really important for Andean religions, in the eastern slopes of Los Andes, in this area. So we can say that there are main three threshold in plant domestication. First, frequent and dispersed domestication. No? Small places of domestication, then this domestication start to spread, and finally the productivity increase, and as a consequence the population start to increase. And if the population start to increase, what happened? They start to organize in societies. Talking about animal domestications, llama, llama, alpaca, and our dear friend, the guinea pig. Three main animals, especially llama and alpaca, were domesticated in Peru more than 4,000 years ago. They are used, and until now they are used, like piece of burden for food, wool, and sacrifice. What about the guinea pig? Also, the evidence suggests that early domestication took place in Peru too, in the central Andes more than 5,000 years ago. And what are the main uses of the guinea pig? Well, I have to say, they look very cute, but the main uses is food. Curing practice and even prevent crop damage. So this is the most important animals that were domesticated in South America. So we have this long period of domestication since 8000 BC until 1750 BC. So this is a long period of domestication. So in this period, the first society will start to appear. Three main concepts for understanding the Andean states. They depend on agriculture production. They depend on cotton. They depend on camelid fiber to make clothes. They build rich ceremonial complex. You can find really big temples for religious purpose. And finally, there is a really complex trade between the highland, a really good place for agricultural production, and the coastline. You have one of the most productive marine seas in the world, in the ocean. So you have this complex trade between the highland ocean. Four characteristics. This is the first period, formative. If you saw formative, so this is the formation of the state. I'm going to talk about here about three societies. Caral, have you heard about Caral? So it's one of the most important in the whole world. Valdivia, also very important in Ecuador, and Chavín de Huántar in Peru. Caral, why I choose Caral? Caral is the earliest civilization in the whole America. Is the first civilization in the whole America. Caral developed in the central coast of Peru. It's one of the six phases of civilization, you know? And they developed a really complex city. You can find pyramids, you can find temples, you can find a real, like a modern city. And really important here is Caral was a complex society, but they didn't have ceramic, they didn't have metallurgy, and they didn't have writing. How a society can develop at that level without having all these characteristics? It's a question that many archaeologists are still thinking about. This is Caral. This is the main temple of Caral. You see, in this place, the people used to meet together to make some sacrifice, religious things. This is two pyramids apart from the temple. Apart from the main temple, you have these two pyramids. And this is an overview of the Caral site. You see, here is a river, a really good place for agricultural production. And actually, Caral is between the mountains and the coastlines. They develop a complex trade between highland and the coastlines. And also, they depend on cotton. That is really important. They depend on cotton. So Caral was the first civilization of the whole America. And you know what is a quipu? The quipu is a tool for counting that especially people from the Andean region use. It's kind of simple, it's made by ropes. But actually, only few people can understand or can decode, can read the quipus. Until now, we don't know exactly how to read a quipu. But mainly, it's used for counting.
Is it writing?
Maybe, it's a kind of writing. But until now, we are sure that it's for counting. Maybe I go to a place, how many alpacas are here? Like 300 alpacas. And I put like, I made some notes, 300 alpacas. There is a hypothesis that is also writing. So in the quipus, some very expert people can write big events, big battles, but we don't know how to read it until now. All the quipu 5,000 years ago. And you can find quipu even until the Inca Empire, and more recently. Second culture, Valdivia. Why I choose Valdivia in the Gulf of Guayaquil? Because they present the earliest pottery in the New World. Pottery is really important in the societies. Valdivia, they depend on agriculture and marine resources. However, they disappear due to a massive volcanic eruption. And this is the distribution, as you see, is really close to the sea, Valdivia. And this is the first pottery in the Americas. It's called the Venus of Valdivia, representation of women. And then we arrive to Chavín de Huántar, also called the early horizon. So What is special in Chavín? Until now you see Caral complex, but the area is kind of small. Valdivia, kind of small, the area. When you arrive to Chavín, the influence of this site, of this place that is called Chavín de Huántar, is spread through a really broad, broad area, almost all the central Andes and the coast. But maybe you are wondering, Chavín wasn't a kingdom? Chavín was an empire? No, Chavín was a religion. Chavín de Huántar is like La Mecca for the Muslims. So Chavín de Huántar, Chavín de Huántar was a religion that spread through the whole central Andes. This time, it was the first time that we see a cultural integration in the central Andes. It was the first time, but not the last one, that we see a cultural integration of the Andes. You want to see the Chavín de Huántar site? This is the entrance of the main temple of Chavín de Huántar. Outside you can find stone heads with fangs. And inside of the temple, I present you the god of Chavín de Huántar. It's called Lanzón. And this is the representation of the god. It's like a man standing like this, and with the fangs here and snakes in the head. Really important, we are in the highland, but this god has a strong influence from jungle animals. See? Even you're in the highland, the influence from the jungle is really strong, especially in regarding gods. So until now we have three key points: Valdivia, early pottery, Caral, the first civilization, and Chavín de Huántar, the first integration of the Andean region. This is called the formative. What happened after hundreds and hundreds of years, the ideology, the religion of Chavín de Huántar started to become weaker and weaker and weaker. What happened next? The societies started to split. And we entered to a new period called the Early Intermediate. Here we can find complex societies, but smaller, because they split. And mainly in the coast. I'm going to talk about here two societies. The Mochicas and the Nazca. Because, you know, maybe this one, because the Nazca lines. The Mochicas developed in the northern part of Peru. If you see Mochicas, is in plural. Why I use plural? Because Mochicas, there were not one kingdom. There were many independent polities. But they shared the same religion and the same ideology. The Mochicas have a really strong military force, very elitist society, and their main achievements were the irrigation, because they live in the desert. They need to make these irrigation technologies, and the ceramic. This is the Huaca del Sol, one of the most important sites for the Mochicas. Inside you can find many representations of gods. This god is called Ayapaek. It's a marine god. And as I told you, there were many independent polities. Each polity has their own leader, but could be a man, lord of Zipán, or could be a woman. Men and women at that time have the same power. And this is the reconstruction, lord of Zipán and lady of Cao, Mochicas rulers. And this is the Mochicas pottery, really beautiful pottery. Through the pottery, they show many things from common life. Portraits, animals, even disease, you see that deformations, and even sexual bodies. Why did Mochica disappear? Maybe you know this one, El Niño. It's a really environmental factor. At that time, it says like it was 7 years of rain and 7 years without rain. Also, another reason is foreign threats, because Mochicas were not alone in the north coast of Peru. And as a consequence, if you have all these bad things happen to you, the ideological, the religion starts to become weaker and weaker and weaker. And what happened? They split. The Mochicas. Now the Nazca. We move into the southern part of the Peru. Nazca. Really important here, Nazca, they didn't have kings. They didn't have a capital. They were also independent groups, and also they shared the same religion. They didn't believe in gods. They believed in natural spirits. So the most important achievement of the Nazca was the polychrome painted pottery. This is the pottery of the Nazca, representing whales, lobsters, and in some cases, individuals. Another achievement, the Nazca lines. Maybe you're wondering, what is the Nazca lines? They are representation of animals in the desert. What is the meaning of these animals? Possibly each animal was the symbol of each clan. For example, I'm the clan of the monkey. Other is the clan of the spider. So you see spiders, monkeys, and many animals there. What is this one? Puquios. Do you remember Nazca used to live in a desert? They dig into the ground to get underground waters. That is the Puquios. It's a technology created by the Nazca and still is used nowadays. So we have here two important societies, Nazca and the Mochicas. Only regional developments, kind of small. What happened next? We see the formative. During that year, during Chavín the Wonder period, there was a unification. Then a split. Now, what do you think is going to happen? Again, another unification by two societies. This is called the Middle Horizon. Now we move again to the highland, and we're going to talk about the two very important societies. Have you heard about the Huari Empire? And the other is the Tiahuanaco sphere of influence. Both of them were international identities because they agrupped many countries like Peru, Bolivia, and Chile. They developed almost at the same time. So this is the distribution of the Huari Empire, mainly in Peru, and the Tiahuanaco in Bolivia, southern Peru, and northern of Chile. So I'm going to compare the two societies because it's really interesting to compare both of them. This is a more detailed map. So Tiahuanaco, the capital city of Tiahuanaco was Tiahuanaco, kind of similar. Tiahuanaco actually is a really old village, but since the 700s started to expand, the main characteristic of Tiahuanaco was the megalithic stone monuments. It was a theocratic society. And really important here, if you think in a kingdom or an empire, there are provinces. And in each province, there are capital of the province. Okay, you cannot find that one in Tiahuanaco. Archaeologists nowadays, they don't know how Tiahuanaco controlled a really big area without having these provincial administrative centers. This is still a really interesting question to answer. If we compare Tiahuanaco with Huari, actually, Huari has a strong influence from Tiahuanaco. Huari developed from another culture, previous culture, the Huarpa culture that developed in the central Andes. The expansion began almost at the same time of Tiahuanaco. Huari has a really complex city, maybe like similar to our cities, orthogonal, like rectangular cities. A strong military power, and they did have provincial administrative centers. That's why I call Tiahuanaco an empire. And that's why I call Huari an empire, and that's why I don't call Tiahuanaco an empire. But what did these two states have in common? This is one of the main goals of Huari, one of the main goals of Tiahuanaco. Look similar? They share the same religion. This god is called the staff god. So Tiahuanaco and Huari, both of them share the same religion. But they had different kind of ceremonies. But in fact, they kept the same religion. This is as one city of Huari. You see, orthogonal, like this, rectangular shape, square shape. The cities were more administrative and residential, like our cities nowadays. In the case of Tiahuanaco, they were more ceremonial. It was a big city. During a period of time, the people used to go to make ceremonies, stay there maybe 2-3 months, and they come back to their own village. So this city is called Piquillacta in Cusco. You can find streets, you can find even two-story buildings, you can find a red network. that connect all the M. If we compare with Tiwanaku, we can find, for example, a pyramid in the capital, semi-subterranean temple, and the Kalasasaya Palace, mainly for ceremonial purpose. What was the legacy? The size iconography, that means the religion was the main legacy. This religion is going to be used until the Inca Empire. Mm-hmm. The Quero, this vessel, is really common after the Huarian Tiwanaku period. It's for drinking. Bronze metallurgy, megalithic structures, and road network, and really complex cities. Why did they disappear? Two reasons. For Huari, economic problems as a consequence of that today's growth. And in Tiwanaku is also more interesting because there is a theory that says it was an uprising. Why? Because the archaeologists found temples that were burned to the ground. So people start make uprisings. We don't know why. Maybe because of the great drought and economic problems. Anyway, Huari and Tiwanaku reshaped the Andean region. And because of this reshaping, half a millennium later, the Incas in this same area would appear. So if you see again our general timeline, it's almost full. There is a gap here. So again, when the Huari and Tiwanaku disappear, again, societies start to appear, smaller societies. Again, a new period, the late intermediate period. Again, we move into the coast. There are many societies here, but here I'm going to talk about that, in my opinion, is the most important, the Chimú Empire. Chimú Empire. They developed in the north and central coast, similar to the Mochicas. According to a legend, the foundation is due to Taikanamo, a mythological being. He found the Chimú Empire, and also he found, you remember this one? Chan Chan, the capital city of the Chimú Empire. Chimú Empire has had a violent conquest, but also they made a really good alliance with all the populations that they controlled. So this is a distribution. At the beginning, they start near to Chan Chan. They move to the north valleys. They move to the southern valleys. They another northern expansion. And since here, they influence northern areas. Regarding the southern part, it's uncertain because we don't know if they really, it was a military conquest or only an economic conquest. But we are not sure, that's why it's uncertain. Chimú Empire took many gods from the Mochicas and many gods from Huari and Tiwanaku. And you're going to see this here. Again, you see the staff gods. In Huari, in Tiwanaku, and now in the Chimú Empire. This is Chan Chan. This is one of the main part of Chan Chan. I know Chan Chan is really big. This is the main entrance of Chan Chan. You can find representation of sea animals, sea birds, what else? Fishes. And also, they work really well with gold. No? The metallurgy was really advanced during this time. So, how did Chimú Empire fall? In 1470, who appeared? Topa Inca Yupanqui, the leader of the Incas. The leader of the Incas, after 3 years of campaign, he could conquer Chan Chan, the capital city of the Chimú Empire. And after this, the Chimú Empire disappeared. But what is important? Elements of Chimú culture were incorporated into the Inca culture. Like the metallurgy, not the work with gold. And see, it's almost full. Chimú Empire here. So, what is next? You know what is next. The Inca Empire. The last cultural integration. Actually, Inca Empire has a really short period of life. It starts in 1432, when the Incas won a battle against their rivals, the Chancas. After this battle, the expansion began, and until 1532, that was the Spanish conquest, the capture of the Inca leader Atahualpa. The Inca Empire was one of the largest empires in the world, the largest empire in the pre-Columbian America, before the Spanish came. It was divided in four. The Antisuyu in the east jungle, the Collasuyu to the southern part, the Contisuyo in the western part, and the Chinchaysuyo in the northern part until Colombia. No? Actually, the Inca Empire covered Colombia, Ecuador, Peru, Bolivia, Argentina, and Chile. And you see, the Cusco is in the middle. The Cusco is the capital. Well, the origins, there are many myths, but actually we don't know where the Incas, what was the origin of the Incas. If you remember, when the in this same area, the Wari Empire developed. After the Wari Empire disappeared, many villages around Cusco started to become abandoned. We are not sure why. In Cusco, this didn't happen. And since 1000 until 1400, Cusco became a really complex city. After the 1400, the expansion of the Incas started. With first, one of the most important leaders of the Inca Empire, Pachacuti. If you see, the red color here is the Cusco after Pachacuti. Then Pachacuti started expansion in this purple area, and thanks to Pachacuti, the Incas conquered the Chimú Empire and then moved on to Ecuador. His son, Tupac Yupanqui, led the southern expansion, Bolivia, southern Peru, north part of Chile and Argentina. Both of them are the most important emperors in this period. His son, Huayna Capac, he conquered here. This place is the place of the Chachapoyas. This place is jungle. It's really difficult to enter to this place. And the Chachapoyas people was a really brave, brave people. And other area was the Gulf of Guayaquil. Also, in this place, there were many, many populations, really strong populations. So, under the Huayna Capac government, the Inca Empire reached the maximum expansion. Since Colombia until the Maule River in Chile, the south. What happened after Huayna Capac? What happened after this succession crisis? Huayna Capac has two sons. Huáscar, born in Cusco, Atahualpa, born in Ecuador. After Huayna Capac is dead, you know what happened. Both start to fight. Like a drama. So, during this succession crisis, the Spanish came. What are the main achievements of the Incas? Well, I can talk about many, many hours about that. I want to summarize really briefly in these pictures. These terraces or terra plays are called andenes, and it's a technology created by the Incas, and also, actually, before the Incas, in order to deal with this really difficult environment. Because the geography is really, really difficult. So using these ones, they could obtain potatoes, corn, and many, many, many species. This is the main god of the Incas, the Inti, the sun. This one looks familiar, a staff god. But for the Incas was the god creator called Viracocha. Viracocha was the creator of everything for them. But you know, it's similar to the staff god. This is called Arivalo, a typical ceramic, Inca ceramic. Important, rope network. Do you remember the Wari started to build rope networks? And then the Inca started to expand these rope networks through the whole empire. Okay, you know, Machu Picchu, residential place. It was like the vacation place for the Inca or the royalty. And of course, they have a really strong military power. They need to construct, to build fortress. This is called Sacsayhuaman Fortress in Cusco. So maybe you're wondering, why did this all big empire fall in a really brief period of time? Well, apart that the Spanish used farigons, there were many factors. First, if you have a big empire, you have many populations that don't agree with you, like the Chachapoyas, like the people in Ecuador. Civil war, disease. What is Capac Ñañ? Capac Ñañ is the name of the road network. Imagine you arrive to a new place, you don't know the geography, but then you find these really beautiful roads, well-constructed roads. If you follow this road, you will reach, you can reach this, the main cities in a really big period of time. The Catalan helped a lot to Spanish to conquer the whole empire. It was good for the Incas, of course, but also it was really good for the Spanish. So, however, there was an Inca resistance that lasts like 40 years, but I don't want to talk about this because it's another history. Really interesting, the Inca resistance. I want to summarize all this presentation in this slide because the Inca took many things from the previous culture. From Caral and Chavín, the Andean cosmovision, the duality. From Nazca and Mochicas, irrigation techniques and marine technologies. Also from the Ecuadorian territories, marine technologies. And from Huari, the complex organization of cities. From Tiahuanaco, religions and megalithic constructions. And from Chimú, the metallurgy. And this is the whole general timeline. You see, we have filled all the timeline. There are more cultures, and I want to talk about more here, maybe you are kind of worried now. But this is the main key societies in the whole America. And finally, acknowledge to the GIC for this opportunity, and to the Peruvian archaeologist Maria Vila, who helped me in this presentation. That is, she's my sister. Thank you so much. Okay.